Greetings, greetings, greetings. Welcome to Wataguan. My name is Donovan Simon. I'm the president for the Jamaican Canadian Association Alberta. And Wataguan is our way of connecting to the community, talking about things that affect us as an association, affect the province, the country, the world. And today we're going to talk about the history of Black people in Canada. You know, we have Emily David Shepherd in the wings. He's going to join us in a little bit. I want to make sure everybody's hearing me and, you know, things coming through loud and clear. So give me a thumbs up. I'm looking for some response from the people out there. Greetings, Raymond. Greetings. Right. Making sure that, you know, the audio is coming through loud and clear. Let me know if it's coming through all right. But of course, before we jump into the discussion, we want to make sure that we honor the tradition of Wataguan and do some staples. And one of them is the Patois word of the day. Jamaican Patois is a beautiful language that we all love to hear, right? So the Patois word for today is Corouches. Corouches. And if you were to use this in a sentence, you'd possibly say, the person moved out and left them corouches. So for the Jamaicans who are on the program, and you know what corouches mean, put it in the comment section. So those who don't, those who don't know it, can learn from it, right? So, yeah, I hear I need some volume. All right, give me a sec. Let me check my volume, because something not working out as it should. Right. All right. Let's hope this is better. So tell me. All right, tell me if the audio is better. It looks better on my end. All right. So hopefully that is sorted out. All right. So like I said, Pato word of the day is carouches. So if you know what carouches mean, put it in the comment section. Put it in the comment section. Things that are coming up. We've got Caribbean Black History Month celebration. It's tomorrow, the 27th. It's going to start at 6 p.m. We're going to be streaming this virtual event live on Facebook. It's going to be on the Caribbean Association of Calgary page, right? Please jump on and support, right? Yeah, carouches, that's the word, Yannick. So tomorrow, 6 o'clock on Facebook Live, Caribbean Black History Month celebration. We're also going to be having a youth art workshop. It's going to be on the 13th of March. It's open for youth 12 to 18 years old. And it's going to be something really special, because what we want to do is to get these youth learning from one of Calgary's bright up and coming artists, Sidonie Warren. And some of that artwork is actually going to be featured in the new JCAA operating location. To register, call 587-429-2860. Or of course you can jump on our page or on our social media and get more information. But we really want to ensure that our young people come and enjoy learning from one of Calgary's bright and up and coming artists and learn about Jamaican culture through art. All right. Of course, we want to continue to talk about our Helping Hands program. We've got a 14 by 16 donor wall in our space. And we want to fill that space with logos recognizing donors all over. So different categories, you can support all the way from, you know, a member category all the way up to the 10K. You'll get featured on Watagwan, your logo will be on our website, you'll get featured on our social media. We're always wanting to have the community contribute and participate in what we're doing. And the donor wall is just one of those things. In our space, in our operating location, is a resource room, which includes a library. And we're looking for Jamaican and Afro-Caribbean books. We want to build the single largest source of Jamaican and Afro-Caribbean books in Canada. That's how ambitious we are with this project. If you've got books, please donate them to us. You can contact us in a number of ways. Jump on our website. You can send us an email. You can make us up. You can call. You can jump on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram. There are a number of ways to get in touch with us to support either the Helping Hands program or the library of Jamaican and Afro-Caribbean content, right? We already have some books in there, but we need hundreds more. So join and support. I was gonna say, you know, get rid of some of the carouches. For some of the people who are just joining, the Patois word of the day is carouches, right? If you know what it means, put, as I see some people putting some answers in already. So yeah, tell us what it means. Right, so that the people who don't understand the Jamaican patois can get a good sense of what it is. Yeah, greetings, Glenn, greetings. All right, today we're gonna talk about the history of Black people in Canada. And in the wings, I have Emily David Shepherd. David, I know you hide your video, but if you can get set and unmute and all of that. Welcome to Watagwan.
Hey, thanks for having me, Dom. Good to be here.
Is the weather treating up in Edmonton, my friend?
It's not too bad. It was a little chilly up here today. Definitely very un-Jamaican weather. Un-Caribbean weather, but pretty typical weather for Edmonton.
All right. You know, Edmonton is where I enjoyed, I don't know if enjoy is the right word, experienced my coldest day in Canada.
What was that temperature?
Minus 49 with a wind.
Okay.
That up to about minus 56. I didn't know that, you know, people could live in temperatures like those. But you know what? Black people do it. Black people have been in Canada for a long time doing all kinds of
Absolutely.
Things, right? Yeah. All right, we're going to get into the discussion. Okay, one, it's Black History Month and we celebrate Black people. Black History Month is primarily a Western thing, you know, Canada, the US. Maybe let's start the discussion, David, about the significance of Black History Month. What does it mean, and what should we take away from it?
Well, I think it's extremely important just because we recognize the challenges that Black communities have had, having recognition. Well, first of all, just getting equality in North America. So, of course, the first Black people to come here were brought here as slaves, had to fight for many years to get their freedom and opportunity. And even once we saw the end of slavery, we had incredible challenges for folks to overcome. We had the Jim Crow laws in the U.S., which is frankly what ended up driving, Black settlers to come up to Alberta originally, and ongoing discrimination. Even when they came to Alberta, they didn't escape that either. So right. Black History Month has been about pushing back against, I guess, that very whitewashed version of history, reminding people that there are Black men and women who have been making enormous contributions to their communities, who have been part of their stories here, and indeed helping us to better understand where we've come from as a province, where we're going, and the opportunities that are here now.
Yeah, and you talk about contributions and contributors. When I was preparing for the program, I was looking through a number of things, and Black people have been in Canada from the early 1600s, right?
Yes,
from way out in Nova Scotia all the way across.
Yeah.
What are some of those contributions, both in Canada and Alberta, that don't get enough mention in your mind?
So I'll be honest, I'm not as up on my history in some other parts of Canada, though I did get a chance to take a trip out to the East Coast a couple years ago. And so I did visit Africville and some of the other settlements and stuff out on the East Coast while I was there. Here in Alberta, there has been some significant things. John Ware, right, the early Black cowboy, he's the one that introduced Longhorn cattle to Alberta. Brought that up from Texas. So he made a lot of contributions as a rancher and a cowboy. J.D. Edwards, one of the early Black settlers who came up to the Amber Valley region, walked from Edmonton to Athabasca, a 3-day walk, I understand. But he was one of the founders of the Wheat Board here in the province of Alberta. We had Violet King Henry and recognition to the government today, who just named the Federal Plaza out front by the legislature building, Violet King Henry Plaza, after her. First Black female lawyer first Black lawyer in Alberta, first Black female lawyer in Canada. Mm-hmm. So we've had some people here who have done and achieved some amazing things.
Yeah. But the question is, has there been enough mention? Has there been enough recognition? And why hasn't it attracted more attention? And I'll come to the recent, celebrating of Blackish Month. But we've done all these things over the years, David. Why hasn't it attracted more attention?
Well, history is written by those who hold the power, right? That we hear the stories of the people that get to tell the stories. And, I don't think it's at all... it's at all racist to note that, generally our society has been run by white men. That is the tradition. The white European men had the balance of power, had the balance of the wealth in Canada. And so they wrote the balance of the history. They wrote the balance of the educational curriculum. And it's not necessarily always about a value judgment. Part of it is just assumption, too. It's the way the human brain works. We talk about what we're familiar with. We talk about what we know. So we heard a lot of stories about white men in Canada. So I think the opportunities, sorry, what was the other part of your questions?
Yeah, just white hasn't gotten more.
Sure.
Yeah.
So Black stories just simply weren't included and weren't told. So they were told amongst the communities. But I know for myself, my father came here from Trinidad in 1967. But for my dad, he converted to Christianity when he was 16 in Trinidad. That meant for him giving up a lot of his culture. He came to Edmonton. He settled in with a white church where he met my mom, and that's where I grew up. So I wasn't connected with the community. And yeah, it wasn't in the curriculum at school.
Right.
So I didn't learn those stories. I was over 40 years old, when I was elected, and I found out that I was only the third Black person ever elected in the province of Alberta to the provincial.
There you go.
And I got invited to a bunch of events to speak for Black History Month in 2016. And unfortunately, that was the first time I'd been to a Black History Month event. Because again, I hadn't been raised in or connected with the community. But I started doing my research. And then that's when I started to learn these stories. And I went, wow, this goes back, over 200 years here in the province of Alberta. And So I had the chance to work with the then Premier Rachel Notley and our Minister of Culture and Tourism to make February 2017 the first official recognition of Black History Month in the province of Alberta. And we reached out and tried to connect with as many of these early Black settlers as we could. So we had nearly, I think, over 80 descendants of those original Black settlers there at the Alberta Legislature, along with near over 400 other people, nearly all Black. It was an amazing thing to see. But that's when I had the chance to actually start to get to know and talk to some of these folks, largely Black women, who have some academics, some just preserving their family history, who've been working to preserve these stories. And they just haven't had the opportunity or the support to get them out there. But I'm really pleased to see that in the last few years, that is starting to change. We're seeing a lot, we're seeing schools step up and wanting to teach this. We're seeing all kinds of organizations step up. We had an exhibit at the Royal Alberta Museum. Universities, colleges are stepping up. So these stories are finally starting to be told.
So, do you think, though, David, that the black people in Alberta and the black people in Canada are embracing it enough and doing enough to tell these stories and the contributions of black people across both Alberta and Canada?
I think so. I have seen the Black community really embracing this more and getting behind it. And let's be clear, the Black community in Edmonton here has been celebrating Black History Month for decades, right? So the National Black Coalition of Canada, the Edmonton chapter, has been celebrating since the mid-80s. So they've been having things like the Black Gospel Night, which takes place tomorrow night here in Edmonton. It's streaming online, so folks can enjoy it from home this year. But they've been doing that event. They've been doing an annual celebration first at Londonderry Mall, then at West Edmonton Mall, other community awards events. There's been groups like Five Artists One Love that's been doing their Black History Month art celebration every year for 15 years. Their 15th anniversary. So this has been happening. But I think having it elevated now, having that official provincial recognition, having more and more others step up, then folks are starting to see themselves in these stories. Because it's understandable, Black youth, if they aren't given a chance to hear these stories, if they aren't given a chance to learn their history, then of course they're not going to be embracing it and celebrating it themselves. But yeah, I really think Black communities have started to come together and really claim this for their own.
All right, you're a politician, so I have to ask about government and the politics. Are the governments at the different level doing enough to show either acceptance or support of Black history and the contribution? I mean, it took us however long, but finally in 2017, Black History Month was recognized here in Alberta, right? Is government doing enough around it?
So I think we're seeing some progress. I mean, we've got your three levels of government. You got the local, municipal, you've got the provincial, you got the federal. So the municipal government here in Edmonton has had some awareness for a while. They provided the funding and support to start the Africa Center here in Edmonton, and I'm not sure exactly how long it's been running, but it's been running for a while, and that's been big in terms of supporting a lot of the Black African communities here in Edmonton, and certainly the Somali communities and others that are sort of larger or that have had some challenges and some struggles. There's been some recognition. There's been some investment there on the municipal level, and I am seeing more and more local municipal communities now that are officially recognized celebrating Black History Month. And indeed, with I think the murder of George Floyd last year, that's becoming a much more prominent conversation now with questions around policing and how we approach community safety. So I have seen, the city of Calgary, I think, stepped up and did some good consultations last year. It remains to be seen what's going to happen in terms of action. City of Edmonton has been digging into some of that, a new anti-racism council. Some would prefer to see some more action rather than another council and consideration. The work is there. On the federal level, we have seen renewed recognition. Like I have never heard a federal government really talk about Black Canadians until Prime Minister Trudeau. So that is something that came in with his government in 2015. So there is at least more conversation. They are putting out some programs and some grants directly targeted to supporting Black communities and Black community organizations. There have been some challenges with how those programs have been initially rolled out, and some concerns with some of the messaging. And so there is a lot more actual work for them to do, but at least we are in the conversation. On the provincial level, We, of course, yeah, we had the official recognition in 2017 under our government. We went, I tried to open that door because, of course, like I said, I was elected in 2015, found out I was only the third black person elected, and I kind of went, wow. Got invited out to a lot of events with, the, black community groups, Caribbean groups and African groups and others. And I saw how much it meant to them to see someone that looked like them in government. And I had a lot of them say, hey, we've never actually even had an MLA come out to our events before. So I really made a commitment then, said, okay, we need to change this. We need to make more room. We need to get more people from the black community engaged and have the opportunity. So, I held a couple consultations in early 2016 at the Alberta Legislature, brought in some of the elders and leaders from the black community, brought in youth from the black community to sit down and talk about some of the concerns and issues. We followed that up in 2018 with our consultations on our Taking Action on Racism plan. So that was after the mosque attack in Quebec. We recognized that there were some challenges that needed to be met. And so that brought forward a bit of an action plan. We created the first Alberta Anti-Racism Advisory Council, established that. We worked really hard to increase representation on our agencies, boards, and commissions. We tried to do as much as we could to open that door and laid a lot of good groundwork. And part of it too was actually working to, in our curriculum update, include Alberta's Black history in our Alberta educational curriculum. So, yeah.
I'm glad you mentioned education because I'm going to go down that road.
Sure.
But before I go there, how do we get more Black people, David, into the process like you have? Lindsay Blackett and a couple others were ahead of
Yeah,
you,
and George
as well,
Rogers, yeah.
right? How do we do that so that Black History Month is not just for some, a token celebration, but more of a continuum of activity where Black people are actively being parts of the decision-making processes
Sure.
and the things that, we move from being token.
Yeah.
You are talking about being the third guy. Hopefully at some point somebody stop counting, right?
Indeed, yes, absolutely. Hopefully at some point it's just a normal thing. Of course there's black people in the legislature because there's black people in Alberta. But yeah, one of the things we have to first of all is recognize is that there are barriers that have kept people from the black community from getting engaged. And again, that's because, like I said, traditionally our power structures and everything have been very white. They were white dominated, they were male dominated. That has slowly shifted over time. We've had some folks that have broken that ground, but it's also taken dedicated work. Like, for example, when we were elected in 2015, we had near gender parity in our caucus. That didn't happen by accident. That's because Rachel told the folks that were doing our candidate search, we need to go out and actively invite women to run for us. And that's a commitment we've made again in 2023. And it's this, we are making the same commitment for racialized candidates. So we are actively going out and reaching out and recruiting and asking folks from racialized communities to run for us. But that's not enough either. It's not enough just to ask people to come in and say, we'll give you a seat at the table, as long as you sort of think like we do and talk like we do. You have to be willing to challenge yourself to allow different viewpoints and perspectives at the table and to empower people to actively, represent their communities, represent their history and experience. So we've been working on a policy process, your future, your voice, your future, and where we've been actively consulting with folks from racialized communities and a lot from the black community about what are the changes we need to make to address systemic racism in the political system. So that's, we've done healthcare, education, we've done public safety and justice, and we're going to be doing one on democratic participation because there are real barriers. If people don't have the chance to get experience, right, to sit on boards, to work in different areas, if they don't get a chance to build networks and relationships with folks who are in political power or have those opportunities, if they don't get the chance to learn about the systems, if they don't get support to do the fundraising and the other things that you need to be able to run as a political candidate, then those doors are effectively closed. So one of the other things I'm really proud of is that I was able to support some folks within the Alberta NDP. We formed something called a Racial Equity Caucus. So it's an incredible group of young leaders, really, who are working to support and elect more racialized candidates.
Okay.
So they actively fundraise, and they're going to be supporting folks that are running in 2023. So those, that's the work we need to be doing to get more people from the Black community at the table.
All right, that's a good point. Let's go back to education. How do we get more Black history, and I'm going to extend it to BIPOC and Indigenous history, into the active discussions and curriculum that is being taught every day? What needs to be done?
I mean, that is absolutely a choice of government, right? And so when we, again, when we were in government, we made that decision. As we were doing the curriculum review, we said we are going to include the full history of the indigenous people who live on this land, including their experience with residential schools, everything they have been through as part of their process of reconciliation. We developed that curriculum. It is currently sitting on a shelf in the education minister's office. And unfortunately, we have heard that they've hired other people to come in and review that curriculum who are undermining a lot of that work. But we did the same with the Black history in the province of Alberta. We made that commitment. We will include that. And my understanding, again, is that that curriculum was largely developed and is sitting on a shelf, waiting for the current government to implement and put it in. We agreed, in fact, to provide that training on Indigenous history and everything to every public servant within the government of Alberta. And that work was underway, I believe, when we had the last election. So it's, you know, so it's that commitment of our leaders. So of course, if we have more leaders from Black communities, from BIPOC communities, from Indigenous communities at the table, then there is the commitment, more commitment to get that work done and able to push that through. But I guess the work we have to do now as communities is let the government know this is a priority for us, that we want that work to continue, that whatever they decide they want to do with the curriculum that we develop, that they ensure they keep those pieces intact and part of things. The other thing that we see is that teachers themselves are embracing this. And it's been incredibly encouraging to see. I get invited to so many schools now. I see so many teachers stepping up to teach their kids about Black history and doing posters and other things. And we see groups like the Black Teachers Association, you know, which sprung up last year again in that wake after the George Floyd murder, who are doing incredible work to advocate and raise that visibility too.
Yeah. So you talk about George Floyd, and I want to segue into that. Is there any benefit, any spin-off from celebrating Black History Month that is going to contribute to greater awareness and some of the changes that the George Floyds of this world, because you know, George Floyd is only one of thousands that have gone down that road. Is celebrating Black History Month going to contribute positively to some of those social changes that need to occur, not just here in Canada, but you know, globally?
Yeah, I think it can. You know, one of the things we have to recognize, you know, well, many people will say during Black History Month, Black history is not just a month. Black history
Right.
is the whole time. We are Black history. Black history goes all year round. And that's absolutely true. So we got to make sure this is not just about one month. But what I would also say is if we are celebrating Black History Month honestly, then we are dealing and grappling with these issues. Because let's be clear. We talk about Black history in the province of Alberta, and it's great to remember John Ware and what a, and how respected and well treated he was. But let's also remember that they called him Nigger John. And Nigger John Ridge is what he was remembered by for many, many years.
Right.
Let's remember that we had cases like the Ku Klux Klan right here in Edmonton, that we had segregated pools and restaurants, that we had, you know, folks that were facing and having to fight against in the courts against discrimination. Hey, let's remember that we had six Black Muslim women that have been attacked here in Edmonton in the last 3 months. That is Black history too. So we need to be grappling with all these things. So, you know, while I, again, I deeply respect and appreciate that the premier and the ministers today changed the Federal Plaza's name to Violet King Henry Plaza to honor her. Then we got to do more than just name things. We need to follow through on the actual actions. We have a report from the Anti-Racism Advisory Council that is sitting on the minister's desk. You know, the co-chair, a strong Black woman from Calgary, Heather Campbell, has called for those recommendations to be publicly released. They have not been yet. Even as we are seeing these open acts of racism on our streets. So Black History Month is our opportunity to celebrate good things, indeed to celebrate diversity and inclusion, but also to advocate for the work that still needs to be done.
And that's an awesome point, David. So when you look at community groups, and there are lots of ethnocultural groups, including the JCAA, what's our role? What place do we fill in this work that you talk about?
Well, Black community groups have been an essential part of building Black communities here in the province of Alberta since the beginning, right? Those original settlers came up. They formed their communities, they built churches, they built schools, they had picnics, they had the Amber Valley baseball team, right? They would have big picnics where folks would come as far as from Winnipeg, for Black community to get together. So that's one of the essential pieces of work that you do. You provide a safe space where Black people can come together, support each other, remember and celebrate your culture, and find strength. The second thing is then helping to use that strength, that community, to get work done. So I know that you guys do great work in the community. You get out and you support youth. You put on programs. You're putting out funding to get good things done. If organizations work together and partner together to do that work, then we are supporting to make sure our communities thrive and that each coming generation is going to be stronger and better positioned to be more involved and more present at all levels of our society. Lastly, the opportunity is there for groups like yours and others to advocate for change that needs to happen. So whether it's getting involved, with the ongoing consultations with Calgary City Council around anti-racism strategies and dealing with systemic racism in policing and other parts of the justice system, whether that's getting involved, you've got a municipal election coming up. Support Black candidates. Support good people who are going to get out there and represent your community and the things you want to get done. And provincially, there's that opportunity too. Or even if it's just advocating for things, if this curriculum is important, well then, hey, write to the Minister of Education. It doesn't have to be negative and attack. It's just, this is what we'd like to see. We'd like to see you do this and organize with others to get that work done. And that's really the opportunities that we have as Black communities to support each other, on that personal level. And I even up all the way up on the policy level.
And as you talk about support, one of the things I know I hear is as a Black community, as Black people, in some cases we're our own worst enemy because we don't support each other enough, right? What's your take?
I think that's true anywhere. Like I said, I grew up in a small church community, and I'll tell you, right? You see churches split into denominations all the time, right? You have disagreements about this belief. Okay, now we've got two churches where we had one. This happens when human beings get together. But what I would say is, I've seen that that can be a challenge, and certainly when I was first elected and starting to meet with a lot of the different Black community organizations, it was kind of like, yeah, I met with this group and they're like, we want to do a youth program. We want to get a space to do this. Okay. Then I talked to this group. We also want to do a youth program and get our own space to do this thing. And so there was all these groups that all had the same goals and the same purposes, but they were all trying to do it alone. So, I spent a lot of time connecting people and encouraging them to work together and sort of saying, hey, if we've got a bunch of voices calling for this thing, instead of just one group, we're more likely to get the work done. So, and I've been seeing that happen. I think for a long time there was a lot more division between, the Caribbean community and the original Black settler community and between the different African communities. But I'm seeing, especially again in the wake of the George Floyd, murder last year and all these other situations, that we are recognizing that we are all in this together. There's a lot of different ways to be Black. There's a lot of different cultures and priorities that we might have, but we all have that one thing in common, that we want fairness, equality, and a better life for our kids. And I think it's happening. Folks are coming in, and especially under the younger generations, they don't see these lines. Right? They're out there and they're working together to get this done. That's something I think some of us older folks in the community could probably learn from and be doing more of that.
All right, I have two more quick questions. Let's look at Canada. I mean, there are a few initiatives. I know that the government has recently launched a number of things. Some people see it as pretty small relative to both the history and the need. Where do you see it taking us as a people? Will it make for enough change to create enough momentum for Black people?
I'd say it's a start. You know, like I said, there's been a few programs, a bit of funding, but certainly I know this latest round of funding that they offered for, you know, if for infrastructure funding for organizations, I don't know a single organization in Alberta that was successful in getting it. And a lot of prominent organizations, Black-led organizations in other parts of Canada, got these letters sort of saying, I'm sorry, you didn't demonstrate clearly enough that you were a Black-led organization. And it was very confusing and problematic. So there is some good start, some good intent, but there are still obviously some real problems with actually getting a working program and actually getting it down to the ground level and the community groups that need that work. And of course, that's a challenge with federal government because they're out in Ottawa, they're pretty high off the ground. It's a little tougher, but it's work that needs to happen. So I'm encouraged. Again, that, you know, Prime Minister Trudeau and, you know, Minister Hussein and some of the other folks who are involved there are at least working harder at this. But obviously, there is still a lot more work to do, I think, for the Black community to get the full support that I think it deserves and needs.
Yeah. All right. One last one. A question came in about media and how we're depicted and some of the things that need to happen there. What's the role of the media in making Black History Month more significant, but even more for it to translate into some of the social change that we're talking about?
It's obvious there's still some real challenges in the media. Over the last year, you know, have seen repeated stories, indeed, again, in the wake of George Floyd. It opened so many doors. We heard Black journalists, reporters, media figures across Canada speaking out about the challenges they have faced in advancing Black stories, or indeed ensuring that their coverage was not biased or discriminatory. So there are still real challenges within those structures, and it can be a real, really difficult place for Black journalists and media figures to be. Mm-hmm. That said, you know, I think that's work we need to continue to push. I'm really encouraged to see a lot of younger generations and others embracing, you know, the media that's more directly available to us, whether that's podcasts, whether that's getting into, you know, community newspaper or journalism, that are offering these opportunities for us to get our own voices out unfiltered. Right. I think there is enormous opportunity out there as we're seeing a lot of the traditional media structure being disrupted. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of room for us to get in and try to make some space. It's going to be a challenge still, and I think there's a lot of work to do. But I see a lot, I will be honest, at least here in Edmonton, I think in Alberta, I have seen a lot more positive coverage during Black History Month in the last few years. You know, every station is doing radio spots, they're doing TV stories. You know, when we had the rally last year, and in the time since, you know, even just incidents of racism, and so we are seeing a real improvement in some of that coverage. Right. But there is still a lot of work to do. But ultimately, I think if we want our stories told well, then we need to stand up and tell them. So that means we need to encourage a lot more and support a lot more Black artists, filmmakers, storytellers, poets, musicians. Get them out there, get their voices out there, support their ability to tell our stories well.
All right, David, this has been awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, David is Emily for, is it Edmonton Central?
Edmonton City Center.
City Center, right. Always a pleasure talking to you, my friend. Hopefully at some point, you know, we get past this COVID pandemic and we can sit down and have a coffee and see how we can continue to build community. But I appreciate your contribution to Watergon.
Thanks for having me. Have a great night.
All right. Take care. That was David Shepherd, guys. Always great to get his experience, the third member of the Alberta, third Black member of the Alberta legislature. For those who joined Watergon late, and I see in the comments, you know, everybody enjoying the Karoches conversation. part of the word of the day, Karoches. And for other people who don't throw out them Karoches, maybe it's time to throw out some Karoches. Next week, we're going to be back again with Watergon. One more episode as we celebrate Black History Month. And that one, I think, is going to be a really hot one. We're going to discuss Black Lives Matter. Is it making progress or is it spinning as we close out our discussions around Black History Month? And then we're going to shift into looking at businesses, and therefore our session after that is going to look at businesses, what makes for the right model. And then we'll get into a discussion the week after about work ethic is it better here than back home in Jamaica? And we'll have a couple of different panelists looking at that. Tomorrow, like I said, is Caribbean Black History Month celebration. Starts at 6 o'clock Mountain Time. Jump on Facebook and look for the Caribbean Associations of Calgary. We're going to stream it on our page as well. So come on and support artists. We're having an art workshop for youth on the 13th of March. If you're 12 to 18, you can get your work showcased in the JCAA operating location. So who knows? Get out and learn from Sidonie Warren. That's it for what to go on for another week. As always, I ask you to follow us on social media, check out our website, like our page, jump on Instagram and see some of the things that we post and leave a comment. Thanks to everybody for joining. As always, stay safe. COVID is still around, right? Until next time. All right. Well, good.
I'm making the corner with amazing. I'm not for running and make the changes. So, I've been here for sure. Don't worry. I'll miss that bum, 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 bum. It's not an easy road. How many cities am I on the kid? I saw them think I better rose. Me say, who feels it most? Ooh, Lord, help me sustain these blows. I cry. It's not an easy road. I'm